Tomorrow, the Joint Constitutional Review Committee will go ahead with public hearings into a possible review of Section 25 of the Constitution. That deals, of course, with property rights and ownership. This as the debate on the expropriation of land without compensation continues. Parliament has received around 700,000 written submissions from the public. Now, the Free Market Foundation's Rule of Law Project has made their submission on the resolution for expropriation for land without compensation, which they feel is a betrayal of the struggle and rather a return to an apartheid system, which will leave mostly poor black citizens as the victims once again. They say that real property rights come with secure title deeds. And we're joined now in the studio by the executive director and co-founder of the Free Market Foundation, Louw. Good evening to you, and thank you for talking to us. I mean, what do you mean when you say that any expropriation without compensation will in fact disadvantage the very people it's meant to assist?
Bongani, you and the viewers, good to be with you, thank you. There's a great myth here, even in the introduction, that this is about land. It's not. The Property Rights Clause deals with all property, everything everyone owns. It's also presumed that it's something to do with white land. It's not. It's to do with all people's land. And the fact that white owned land has not fallen in price tells us probably that not many white people expect this to have any effect on them. What we need to understand is that this will apply long beyond the existing politicians. So whatever President Ramaphosa says is completely irrelevant about how the law will be implemented, not only because it will outlive him perhaps by generations, but because he won't be anywhere near it whenever there's an expropriation. Expropriations are done by petty officials in every government department, in every town and village, when they want to extend a park or they want to make a cemetery or they want to make a road, they expropriate land. Now, if you give this power to thousands of petty officials, then imagine how they're going to implement it. If they try and implement it against a rich person living in Bryanston, they will face a very formidable challenge. If they try and implement it against my retired housekeeper, Gladys Nkosi, living in Ivory Park, what will she do? She will be helpless. It is an invitation to corruption, abuse, bribery, racism, religious discrimination, victimizing someone who you don't like the politics of for generations into the future. Black South Africans have been victims of expropriation without compensation. It would be very perverse to put them back in the position they were during apartheid.
So what do you propose instead?
Well, instead, to achieve what? Now, everybody thinks this is about land. If you want to know how to get land transformed, well, firstly, it is happening at a fantastically impressive rate through the market. Over half of all new land acquisitions in South Africa are black South Africans. We're talking about middle-class people in middle-class suburbs. Those are the people whose property rights are now secure by Section 25 and for whom the security will be taken away. What we should do is firstly encourage that. And
but aren't you misrepresenting the facts? I mean, there's no one who's arguing that people whom, as you've just described, have recently come into ownership of land are going to lose their land. Rather, it's to redress for those who haven't, whose land was dispossessed. Aren't you rather conveniently changing the facts to suit an argument?
Bongani, I hate to say this for a seasoned and skilled journalist like you, but you have fallen for the rhetoric here. That is not what the provision has anything to do with at all. This is not about people who acquired land improperly or got it from apartheid or through apartheid or was once expropriated. This is all property. It is your bucky, your car, your shop, your business, your
but
pensions.
With respect, the president has said this is going to be done in a constitutional manner. This, in fact, is part of the process that you've made submissions to yourselves. So this idea that they're going to come for your bucky, they're going to come from your microwave oven, they're going to come for your house, is just fear-mongering. And it's not dealing with the facts.
No, it is dealing with the facts because this power is being given, not to him. He won't be anywhere near. He won't have anything to do with it. What he says is utterly irrelevant.
But again, we have a constitution.
This power is being given to junior petty officials.
With respect, though, we have a constitution. We have a legal process that is underway that's going to review all of this. There's no clarity as to what the final picture will look like. And it's precisely the objections that people like you raise that feed into the frenzy of fear instead of helping the conversation move in a constructive way.
Now, as Joel Nichatenzi, one of the leading intellectuals within the ANC, Lawrence Mavundla, the president of former black of NAFCOC and of ACHIB, Richard Mbolokwana, the president of Alexander Property Owners Association, have pointed out. This has got nothing to do with that at all. This has got to do with whether you empower. And the Constitution, by the way, now says, as Joel Nchitenzi points out, that anyone's property is taken must be justly compensated or fairly compensated. As he says, who's against that? This is precisely the point. This is a proposal to remove justice.
No, but this is precisely the point. There is a constitution, there's a legal framework within which all of this is going to be decided. There's no clarity that the scenario you're painting is the one that is going to happen, but you're jumping on the extremes of the matter and you're causing a lot of fear, people would say, because your position doesn't recognize that we have thousands, if not millions, of black people in this country who were dispossessed through an oppressive system legislated, by the way, and backed up by a violent and oppressive system. You're willing to push all of that aside, and in the interests of that said majority, you're going to the fringes of this matter without looking at the constitutional process it needs to follow.
Well, no, it's the other way around. I do want to cause fear. I want to cause fear, alarm, and outrage.
That's exactly
black South Africans. That's what I want to do.
That's what you're doing.
I want black South Africans to say, this must never happen again. We have been victims of it. Now that we have democracy and freedom and equality, don't you dare take away our security of property.
But again, no one has said that's exactly how it's going to be.
No, that is what is proposed. That is what is under consideration.
Things are under consideration. That's why this review process has received, according to them, nearly 700,000 submissions. You can't take one or two on the most extreme fringes and say that's how it's going to be applied.
No, Bongani, what is proposed is very simple. The removal of the provision that says nobody's property, which means anything anyone owns, regardless of when they got it, present, past or future, can be taken without compensation. That is what
is
on the table.
You and I know that even if that was the only thing that was on the table, it wouldn't stand up to constitutional muster.
No, it might. Absolutely no. The whole point is that three quarters of the parliament can amend the clause. That is what is under consideration, is amending the constitution to take away the constitutional protection you think will survive this amendment. If this amendment occurs, what you have in mind will be gone. And you and your grandchildren will live in a world in which you can be victimized by petty officials who will be able to take your land, the parks manager of Pofadder, or the cemetery manager of Babanango, will be endowed with the power to take property without compensation. And that property doesn't have to be land. It can be a spaza shop. It can be a business. It can be shares. The biggest investor on the stock exchange is owned overwhelmingly by black South Africans, the Public Investment Corporation. All of that will be subject to expropriation without compensation, which the present constitution prevents.
You talk about the free market and how, you know, we've seen a process of new ownership by particularly the black middle class. But many people would ask the question, how are poor people going to have access to that open market? Many would argue that, in fact, the hand of the market has been quite invisible to the black majority because of institutional barriers to access to credit and the like, that you need some kind of intervention.
This thrills me, this question, because that is precisely the issue. I work, my daily life is getting dust on my boots in shanty towns and squatter settlements and peasant farms. And for example, if I can just mention one, the town of Marathon and Delport in Germiston, Kruleni, where the people there are living in shanties and are not allowed to own their land, not allowed to own their houses. They're not even allowed to improve the quality of their tin shacks. Those are the people who I'm working with, and by the way, as it happens with the EFF and others, to maybe take the council and all councils in South Africa to the Constitutional Court and say that they may not continue to oppress poor people with town planning laws, with building codes, with health and safety codes, which simply say that if you can't live in the first world, you have to live in a box or a tin shack.
Mr. Leon, I want to quote something that Alan Paton, who arguably by some is the greatest liberal mind South Africa has produced, and he wrote this 56 years ago. He said, all laws which place racial restrictions of land ownership, of course, was looking forward to a future, says, will be repealed. This alone will not suffice to remedy the present unjust distribution of land, since the dispossessed majority lack the means to buy land on an open market. The government will therefore assist the process of redistribution. He goes on to specifics about how that might be done. But the point is, even he recognized all those years ago that this very process we are now discussing is necessary and the right remedy to the past injustices.
As do I. I agree completely with that quote, every single word of it. Nowhere did he say that somebody who justly bought land, let me just put this to you, it's a simple analogy. If a family, if your family adopts two kids, a white boy and a black boy, and those two kids buy neighboring pieces of land, farms or shops or businesses right next to each other, they go to the same school, live in the same home, and they both buy, this is the question. Is somebody suggesting that the one who happens to have a white skin should be subject to expropriation without compensation?
But again, I put it to you that that has not been conclusively decided. That's what this whole process, which you are a part of, in making your submissions, will decide. We don't know what the final beast will look like. And until we do, all you're doing is fear-mongering.
No, I'm trying to...
Of course you are. That's your stated intention. You've said so in this interview.
I'm trying to get people to understand what is being proposed and oppose it. That is, how do I do that other than to persuade people to understand what is under consideration?
In the most divisive manner you possibly can.
Dividing who against who?
In the most scary manner that you probably
can. Who's being divided?
You're saying that they're going to go after white land, for example.
I never said that. I never said that once.
You've just said now in your example that
you use. No, I'm saying, is that what is being proposed? I'm asking... I'm saying... that they won't. I'm saying the overwhelming victims by large numbers will be poor people, and those are overwhelmingly black people. White people will be hardly affected by this, and I would actually encourage them to relax. The people who ought to panic are the people living in shanty towns and shacks and running spaza shops and small businesses. These are the people who need protection and who need to be alerted to what is being considered.
Be afraid. Be very afraid. Okay, we'll leave it there with the executive director and co-founder of the Free Market Foundation, Louw, and that's his concern around land expropriation.